Hi, and welcome to the FIFPRO podcast, Changing the Game. I'm Allie Riley. In this series, we'll be speaking to international female footballers about their personal journeys to success and find out what it's taken for them to reach the top of their game. And in celebration of the 30th anniversary of the FIFA Women's World Cup, we'll also be looking at how women's football has evolved over the last three decades and discuss what more needs to be done to protect the well-being of players and ensure that future generations can reach their full potential. Today, I'm talking with Lucy Bronze.
You probably need more player feedback in women's football than you do in men's, because equally the spectrum and the range of experience that players have been through, even just in my own team, like even at a place like City, the experiences are completely different.
Lucy is one of the most accomplished players in English women's football. She debuted for her country in 2013 and during her career to date has won three Women's Super League titles, three Women's Champions League titles, plus numerous individual awards, including the UEFA Women's Player of the Year, England Player of the Year, and Best FIFA Women's Player of 2020. In this episode, we'll be looking back at the Women's World Cup of 2015. Lucy, thank you so much for being on the FIFPRO podcast. Let's get right into it, back to a time that I hope you have fond memories of. It may seem like a lifetime ago now because so much has happened since then, but what are the first feelings that come to mind when you think about the 2015 FIFA Women's World Cup in Canada?
I mean, I think for me personally, that's when I scored two goals in a World Cup, which, as you know, for a fullback, they come few and far between the goals. So yeah, to get them in a World Cup and in the winning goals as well. And I think people forget as well, that World Cup in 2015, that was the first time England won a knockout game at the World Cup. That's crazy. Like, we're England. Like, we've had players like Kelly Smith and Rachel Yankee and Farrah Williams and all these amazing players. Yet, actually, it was only in 2015 where we actually got through knockout rounds.
And beating Germany, too, for the first time. And I think now, too, again, so much has happened since that specific tournament. And England is absolutely regarded as one of the top teams in the world and such recognizable players and always has been. But yes, when you mention that, it is a bit hard to believe that that was kind of this turning point for the team. So how did that feel? I guess, what were the expectations going in? What did it feel like to qualify? And then when you were so successful, kind of what was that journey like for the team? And for you personally, being your first World Cup and having such an outstanding tournament?
Yeah, I think obviously, the qualifications, we generally do quite well qualifying. But I think the expectation was, like, it's so cliche, but it's like, let's take each game as it comes. Let's try and get through the group. You know, we had a tough group as well. Our first game was against France. France had an unbelievable team at the time. And even that game alone, it was like, right, let's just get through 90 minutes without completely messing this up. We had such a good squad, but like I said, we never won knockout games, so the expectation on us wasn't really to go and win the whole thing, although the talent that we had, we kind of thought, yeah, we should be able to do well. But Mark Sampson was the manager at the time, and I think he was trying to manage expectation but push us. I think he was a bit like, you know, we've got nothing to lose, no one's expecting England to win the World Cup or make the final. But yeah, I think we kind of just found our route and just kind of sneaked through each game and made each game like really special in some sort of way.
So would you say then going into the 2019 Women's World Cup in France, was it more pressure, a different feeling? You know, I think a lot changed domestically in terms of what the landscape of women's football looked like in England in those 4 years.
Yeah, well, I think the 2015 World Cup really kind of set the domestic league alight a little bit. You know, we had the WSL in place and it was doing well, but I think in women's football, international football is so big that it just has that huge scope to kind of reach so many different people. And because we were sort of successful in the World Cup, we kind of came home and people were a bit more aware. So yeah, I think people started watching the league a little bit more. You know, the FA also wanted to invest in the league more because it was like, oh, well, we've got a bronze medal without really having the expectation of going to try and win the thing. What potentially could we do if we invest a bit more into the league, into the structure, into the team and everything? So yeah, I think from 2015 to 2019, it was completely different. But as a player, like, I think it's funny because I always say, like, my career has been the perfect kind of matchup with women's football. Like when I was 20, I went to university, I had a job, I didn't get paid, I didn't have training kit. We trained like twice a week and that was supposedly professional. And then as women's football kind of got bigger, like 2015 kicked it off in England, that was when my career also kind of kicked off. So I've kind of been on this upward kind of trajectory, I suppose, with women's football. Whereas I think there's a lot of players that I play with now who've never been at that kind of more bottom end of women's football where it was just, you just played it because you love playing it. And then equally, like the older players probably aren't getting to enjoy as much this kind of professional lifestyle that we're all coming to know as kind of a common thing, well, especially in England with the league the way it is. So yeah, I think for me, I've kind of been along that journey. So to be at 2015 and then 2019, it's quite nice to see like the differences in the team and the expectation on individuals, but as the team itself as well, it's really changed a lot.
Yeah, and let's not forget the younger players who now this is all they know is kind of this investment. And of course, we know it could be a lot better. It should be a lot better in terms of investment and salaries and standards. But I always notice this difference with these younger players who didn't even experience that part that you did, you know? So there's definitely these generational differences that are so interesting within a team. And eventually, hopefully, you know, when these young players are the oldest, I hope there's still that kind of respect and appreciation how far we've come, but it will be very different when no one on the team has a story like yours or like mine when, you know, there was no money and you're washing your own clothes.
Yeah, 100%. I mean, them stories are slowly disappearing over time. When I think I turned 30 soon and I'm probably one of the last of that kind of generation, well, in England anyway, I was playing for England and I had a job and going to university and everything like that. That's unheard of now, like all the English players. They play professionally full-time, like Lauren Hemp. I play at City with her. The girl's like 20, 21. That's just football. Like, it's just, that's all she does. She doesn't go to uni. Not that she couldn't, but yeah, she doesn't. Like, that's just the lifestyle. You turn up to Man City where you've got this training facility and as simple as your training kit's washed for you and you've got your food on your plate. Sounds funny, but yeah, like, those are things perhaps people could take for granted. But I think equally in 10 years' time, you know, those little 10-year-olds who are running around now, their careers in comparison to the people who are now playing now is going to be so different. And the World Cups are going to be so different. You would like to think, at least.
Yes, exactly. Let's hope. Let's hope. That's what we're all pushing for. So you mentioned some of those names, you know, like the Kelly Smiths and Rachel Yankees. You've mentioned that you were working and you were in uni, but when you were little, what was the atmosphere like, the opinion around the women's game? Like, how early did you know that you could play for England or you could be a professional soccer player?
I think I only realized I could be a professional when I was probably about 20. In England, years ago, the rule was when you turned 12, you couldn't play with the boys anymore. I only ever played with boys. And then that rule came into place and the coach had to tell my mum, Lucy can't play anymore. Like, we need to find her a team of girls. That was the first time I really realized that I was a girl in a boys' team. I don't think I'd ever really associated that. I think I had quite a good time in boys' football. I played with all my friends who I went to school with. Like, it was a great time for me. And then I never really thought, oh, that's boys and I'm girls and I don't see girls on the telly. I only see David Beckham and Steven Gerrard and whoever else. I never really thought, oh, that's, I can't do that until I was 12. And then it was like, no, you can't do that. And then I'd literally never heard of women's football. And then even when I played for a girls' team, I still hadn't heard of it. And then it was slowly my mum kind of Googling things. And that's when I first heard of like Kelly Smith, Rachel Yankee were kind of the two English ones. Mia Hamm. I was quite fortunate, I guess, because my mum, like, she found out what soccer was in America. Otherwise, I don't think I would have had the same sort of career that I've had because I had got to experience UNC and anybody that knows UNC back then. It was a pretty cool experience, although I only stayed for the one season. I think it was an experience that kind of changed my career, not my path, but like just the way I thought of myself and women's football.
Why didn't you want to stay longer?
Well, the reason I went was, funnily enough, England told me that I wasn't good enough for their like education system that they had set up in England. We knew Anson quite well by then. So Anson Dorrance had said, yeah, come over. Went over, absolutely loved it. Played with some of the best players like Tobin Heath, Megan Klingenberg, Ashton Harris, like the list just went on. Who people in England, again, have no idea of these people back then. And I'd be coming back like, yeah, like this is my team. And they're like, who? Whereas they all know who they are now.
Yeah.
So yeah, I was there for the first season and I was struggling flying back and forth for England camps. And England kind of turned around and said, it's a bit much for you. We're not going to pick you anymore. And kind of the whole reason I went was because I wanted to keep up with the girls who went to that England setup. So I thought I was going to be like kind of left behind because I've never really had my foot in the door properly at England. And yeah, when you're like 17, 18, you think it's the end of the world if they say they're not going to pick you. So I came back to England, picked up like a really bad injury anyway, coincidentally, and ended up being on crutches for a long time and just finishing my studies in England, which again, it was like not ideal, but I think you learn more from those kind of scenarios than you do from, oh, I stayed at UNC for 4 years and won 4 national championships or something. Like, I had all like kind of my hiccups and my major injuries and like these hard times when I was younger that set me up for the rest of my career where I was like, hit me with anything and it's not going to faze me.
So you mentioned Anson and Mark. What are the behaviors that a coach does to get the best out of you and a team, having had these successful tournaments and been at, you know, one of the top college environments in this country?
Yeah, well, I think like Anson's, Dorrance's like philosophy is like all around competition, which for some reason that's just been born and bred in my own brain and my own philosophy anyway. I think it's from having an older brother and just constantly being competitive with him. But in England in general, well, I think it's changing a bit now. But when I was younger, it was like a little girl can't be competitive and want to win and want to fight and, you know, go toe to toe, shoulder to shoulder with the boys. Like it was not like my parents and the coaches never frowned upon it. But I think it's kind of more of a societal thing. Whereas going to the US and like soccer is not necessarily a boys' sport.
Right. Yeah. If anything, it's a women's sport with how it's celebrated here.
Exactly. So it's so different to then what it was like in England. And then, yeah, put that together with Anson and the girls that he had in the team at the time. It was all about competition and winning and beating each other and being the best, which I just absolutely thrived on. That was the first time, that's what I mean, that was the first time I'd been in that environment where it was like, it's okay to want to like beat someone and not show off, but be like, yeah, I won, which I think is kind of like an important part of like a mentality that you need to be the best or to do well in a sport is you need that self-confidence and self-belief, which is kind of that same wavelength. So yeah, I think I've really thrived there and really learned that actually the way I was fine. But yeah, all the coaches that I've had that have kind of brought the best out of me has always been about challenge in some way, shape or form, whether that's being competitive or challenging me and saying, like, Lucy, I think you could do this. Phil Neville was one that he used to come out all the time in the media and say, Lucy Bronze is the best player in the world. And I was like, you need to stop saying that. Like, I'm not the best player in the world. He was like, no, I'm going to keep saying it. And it was almost like he was telling everybody so that I then had to like live up to that and like push myself to be that person. Mm-hmm. I had that with all of my England managers, really. There's always been that challenge to like push, like Mark Sampson was the same.
It's so interesting to hear that because obviously, I mean, I hope anyone listening would know that, you know, you were named best player in the world and FIFPRO best 11, and you have these accolades that these coaches obviously saw that potential for you. But I think you nail the most important part of that is that they knew that you had it in you. Because I think if coaches just put that on players who don't have that, you can break someone. And if you're you know, manifesting these things for them or the pressure, but because they actually got to know you and could see you and what you thrived off of, it was so successful.
Yeah, 100%. I've always had that, like, I've always felt like misunderstood, not always by coaches, but by other people. But I think that was something that the England coaches especially really got to like understand me and managing different players and different ways of working. And I think that's what the best managers do ultimately, because there is not 2 players who are exactly the same in the way that they think or the way that they do things. There's similarities in people, but there's never ever just one way to do something. Which again, I think that was something that I found in my career. Like I learned that quite early on. In England, there's always been like one way to do things. And I think I kind of broke away from that and wanted to do it the way that suited me and in my way and talk the way I talk about being competitive or what have you, whereas English way is a little bit different. But I think it's changing. I think that's been an important thing in English football, especially in the England women's team. I think that's probably what's changed us for the better, is that we've allowed ourselves to be a little bit different, both as individuals and as a collective team. It just takes a little bit of time, I guess.
Well, on that and kind of the English culture and the media, I know that England as a national team has had different approaches towards social media, if players are going to be using it or not during a tournament. And then you now, with your success in becoming a very recognizable public figure, how has your relationship with social media or media in general kind of changed over these years? And have you been able to get to a place where you feel like you can use it as an effective platform, being the public figure you are?
Yeah, I'd say like a roller coaster, the journey. Like, I think when you first kind of hit headlines in a way, like, again, was probably 2015 for me, after scoring a really good goal that sent England through and all this. And it was like, I would be refreshing Twitter and Instagram, and it was like, Lisa Brown's amazing. And you think, like I was in my early 20s, so it was just like, yeah, this is the best thing ever. Like, kept watching the video over and everything that people had to say, and I thought, oh, this is amazing, this is the best thing ever. But you find out how quickly the tides can turn and that can change. And I think I'm quite a strong-minded person anyway. I'm not easily like swayed by other people's opinions, but ultimately, like, what people have to say about you, good or bad, the bad things just always stick a little bit harder. Much as you can sit there and say, oh, I don't listen to it, I don't care, you do. You've read it, you've seen it. That is somewhere in your brain. Whether you choose to think about it or not, it's in that head. And people deal with it in a different way, but I think it always has like some sort of slight negative impact on the way that you think or feel. So I think there was a point where I literally didn't go on social media for about 6 months. But then I have this argument, and I've had it with like Marizan before, with Kim Little before, with other players. And I say social media is kind of what's made women's football. And it's kind of the root of the success and getting the information out there, whether it's scores or games or highlights or goals. That's our visibility when we've not had these great TV deals, which are now starting to like boost the game and things. So I always say to like these players who I've played with or met and who aren't as like active on social media, I kind of get frustrated, because I think, take Kim Little for example, she doesn't like Instagram at all. She don't like social media. That's fine, I get it. Everybody has their different ways of living and stuff, and she doesn't like it. But I'm like, you're one of the best players. You have been the best player in the English league multiple times. You've been the best player in the US league before. You've been one of the best players in the world. I want people to know who you are, so that when they watch women's football, they watch out for you, not someone else who's just posted more on social media. The same with like Marizan. I want people to know your profile, because you're the best player that I've ever played with. So everybody should be recognizing you, not somebody else because they did something funny with the cat on Instagram, which is cool. Like, it's still cool. And like, I'm not saying people shouldn't do that, and I'm not being down on people who do things and have big profiles, because I think it's great that, I just think everybody should. But I think the players who are some of the most talented players sometimes tend to be kind of introvert and don't tend to like social media. And I'm like, you're missing out on opportunity for women's football. Forget about yourself for a second. You got opportunity to grow the game because you're so talented that I want people to watch you. At a time when, say, when I played on the same team as Maro, and I'm like, I want people to know who you are, not who I am, because you're better than me. Like when people go to watch Barcelona for the past 10 years, obviously not this year, they all watch for Messi. He's the best player. They don't watch for like PK or somebody else and set the standards off them. They set the standard off of Messi. Men's football's amazing. This generation's amazing because look how good Messi is. We need to do that in women's football as well. But sometimes different people get put in the spotlight and pushed higher, and it's not always based off of talent. And sometimes that's individuals' reluctantness to use social media, as well as commercial outlets picking people for whatever reasons. But you can only affect what you can affect. So I try and affect the players around me and tell them to try to get Kim to put on Instagram and during the Olympics, but it didn't really work. Well, I had my say at least, so I felt a bit better.
Well, it's one of those things, because it shouldn't have to be us players doing it, but we're at this time in this journey, hopefully towards something better, where there's not enough exposure for people to pick out what player that they like. It's like the ones that are on commercials and the ones that maybe are more active are then going to get deals and get the attention because, like you say, social media has been our form of visibility. And I think that's something that I'm sure you notice compared from 2015 World Cup, where it was the media from the outside, which was decent, compared to 2019, where there was the outside media plus all of us sharing and the fans sharing. And so when companies are saying women's sports isn't worth investing in, we can prove them wrong. You're like, look at all of the engagement with Lucy Bronze's post. Look at the engagement on this highlight of a goal from a women's World Cup. And it's undeniable. And so we've kind of found that as our outlet. But of course, one day, hopefully, it wouldn't have to be us promoting ourselves, you know?
Yeah, exactly. And I think as well, the thing with the World Cup is you don't necessarily always have to promote that. Like you said, 2019, but the World Cup only happens once every 4 years. And then the rest of the year is kind of left for players.
Yeah, fill those gaps.
Yeah, to fill those gaps and to promote and for the good of the game as well, and as well as themselves. Like, I get that. Like, we all started playing football on our own at some point. Like, as much as you play a team sport, you are there for your success as well.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I do get people building their profiles. I just wish we all could at the same kind of rate so that the best players would be like, you know, like your Kim Littles. Like, she's the best example for me because she could be like a superstar now, but she doesn't want that, which is fair enough. But I want that for her, I guess.
No, I get it. Well, speaking of kind of the media and how fickle they can be, how then, I don't want to say important or different, but what is that feeling of being recognized by your peers then in an accolade such as a FIFPRO World 11, where you know that's coming from your colleagues from around the world and not a media or a governing body?
Yeah, I mean, I've always said since day one, even when I was like under 15s and I would get like a player's player or something, this is always the best award. Like, these are the players that play either with you, so know how much better it is to have you on their team, or against you, so they know how hard it is to play against you. Like, they're on the ground, like, it's you know, it's so easy to sit there in an armchair at home and be like, oh, like, Lucy did this and so-and-so did that and she's crap and whatever. But when you're on the pitch, that's when, like, you really feel how fast someone is or how strong they are or, like, how quick their feet are. So the accolades that are player-based are always the best. But I guess there's still that kind of gap of accessibility because I know everybody in the English league. I tend to watch the highlights of the NWSL. Highlights only really show goals scored or saved. Therefore, you miss out like 75% of actually the players who are playing.
All the defenders.
Right, exactly. Hence why there's a lot of awards that tend to be stacked with strikers or goal scorers or assisters, like, or the teams that win the Champions League final or the Olympic final, because those are the games that are watched the most.
Yeah.
Even as players ourselves, we don't always tend to watch every single game of every single league. Like, it's impossible. I can honestly say, outside of the NWSL in Europe, have I really watched that many women's games for the rest of the world? No. Have I tried? Like, occasionally, yeah, but not as hard as I would try to watch a game in the NWSL or in the WSL or in Spanish league or in the French league.
Well, speaking of France, obviously you had a very successful tenure there. I think at least 9 trophies in 3 years. I mean, what was it like being at a club so successful? And is there something that you think other clubs around the world or federations in general can learn from that? Is it, what's the difference? Is it the investment? Is it the culture? What was your experience like there?
Yeah, like, alongside this experience that I had in the States, I think going to Lyon and playing in that team was probably one of the best experiences that I've had in my career, both on and off the pitch. I think with Lyon, everyone always talks about the investment, and 100% the investment, like, oh, that's the president there. He's such a crazy guy. The investment is so good. But I think it's like, he invests personally in it. He's the president of the entire club, and he flies to the away games with the girls. He comes to all the big games. He comes to all the home games. Like, he would know how my season was every year that I was there. because he was invested in it, in himself, not just his like bank balance. For me, that was a big difference. I think you can invest all the money in the world, but ultimately, if you don't know the structure's not right or the investment's not going to the right place, or you don't see hands-on like the problems that need fixing or the things that are going right, sometimes that money can just get wasted. Like in England especially, like we have such big clubs that the investment comes largely from the men's side. These men's clubs are huge. Man City, Man United, Arsenal, Chelsea, Tottenham, like these clubs are global, the biggest clubs in the world, bar like a couple more in Europe. So like the investment's obviously there. They want to do well, but the difference in Leon is actually having the guy at the very, very top invest his like time and his energy. Like he cares. He came to all like the Ballon d'Or awards with us, all like the FIFA awards with us. He was so happy if like Ada won the Ballon d'Or that year. Like you should have seen his face. It was like his daughter had just won it. Like that's literally like how invested he is. And plus he kind of got on like the whole women's football train a lot earlier than the rest of Europe. Hence why Leon was so successful. People are catching up now because they've been invested. Say like Chelsea have been invested for a little bit longer than most people. Barcelona's the same. Like Wolfsburg's, PSG's, they're investing for a long time. And now they're catching up. But Leon did it for so long. That's why the structure was just so sound and so steady for so long, because he just got it right. And he did things differently to other teams. But I guess a lot of teams are learning that now, and the investment and the time is really making a difference.
Yeah, certainly. And you mentioning it, and that's not necessarily a story or a side of it that gets told a lot. So I think that's really interesting. And unfortunately, as we're saying, there's not a lot of clubs necessarily or federations that have understood that, which leads me to the question, how important do you think, I mean, we're definitely seeing it in the NWSL right now, which I'm sure you've seen, player involvement, a seat at the table, whether it's FIFPRO, FIFA, UEFA, the NWSL Players Association, these different unions, how much do you think it helps to have players, current players, former players, able to give their voice and opinion in the sport that we play instead of, or in addition to, these older, maybe traditional, usually men making all the decisions?
I personally think it's the most important thing, player feedback, especially in women's football. Like, I think in men's football, there's kind of been like a steady rate and it's a straight line. That's the end goal. And this is how we get there. Whereas we've kind of been catching up the men's game whilst trying to make it our own game, whilst having our own hurdles to come up against, whilst under the same roof as men's football, being worked the same way but different. Hence why you probably need more player feedback in women's football than you do in men's, because equally the spectrum and the range of experience that players have been through, even just in my own team, like even at a place like City, the experiences are completely different. Even in the national team or national team to national team, I can imagine like the Olympic finals, Canada and Sweden, even the way those two teams are set up and their history and what goes on in their governing bodies would be so different, yet they both got to that final some way, shape or form. Yeah, I think the opinion of players in women's football is more important than men's football, 100%. And I think you can see when people do listen more to the players, changes are made quicker and better. I think the NWSL for me, I think as a domestic league, probably sets a standard in that. What the girls do in the league is pretty special. And I think it gives the rest of the world confidence. I think you see that in what's happening at the minute. It's kind of trickled over and like I know in England, everybody's talking about it. And then we want to make a difference. And then we're standing up and we want to speak about it and we want to sort it in our league. And then I can imagine it's just going to carry on and this kind of wave's going to just grow and get bigger and bigger. But yeah, like you said, it all started from a player's voice, really. Women's football has so much further that we can take it and that we can go. And I think the best way to do it is to listen to the players.
Yeah, absolutely. What was your favorite moment of the 2015 World Cup? It can be your own goal for sure when you scored.
That like kind of moment in time was probably my favorite. And I think there's like a lot of things that kind of added to it that people probably didn't know. Like Jordan Nobbs, I've known her since we were like 14, 15. We've come up through like the age groups together. We played together at Sunderland. Like, we're both from the northeast of England. We both kind of broke into the England set up at the same time. We went to the Euros the year before. Neither of us played a minute. Like, sat on the bench next to each other, just like, not messing about, but like, we enjoyed ourselves, you know, the younger players in the team and stuff. And then we went to the World Cup, and that was meant to be like both of us kind of breaking in. But she unfortunately like got injured quite early on, and she just could never get going in the tournament. She played one game and that was about it. So we sat next to each other every day on the bus. We had this bet, which I actually didn't keep it to, but we basically said, if one of us score, we've got to do this handshake together, and you've got to get a tattoo on the place that you score, because we were like these little kids and we were thinking, like, I was like, I'm not going to score. So yeah, like, we made this handshake up. And then it was kind of more because she was like so down on herself because she was injured and things. And then Jordan was actually the vice captain of England at the time. And coincidentally, I don't know if I'm supposed to tell everyone, but she kind of found out the team the night before this knockout game. And normally Alex Scott was the right back. And Alex is like a really good friend of both mine and Jordan's as well. But Jordan found out that I was playing. And obviously she's injured, so she's not really meant to run. But I was sat in her room with Jodie Taylor, and she ran in the room. She jumped on the bench. She was like, Lucy, you're starting tomorrow. You're starting in the game. I can't believe it. Like, you're playing. So it was like a really big moment, because like, I've got my spot in the team at right back for like the first time ever. Jordan's so excited for me. Like, that's the only thing that's really given her like any sort of hope in this World Cup. So then we like kicked the game off. The first half was terrible. I think we're like one down or something. Second half come out, we were loads better. We changed our shape. Steph scored, then I scored the winner. I ran over at Jordan and like, we've done this handshake. And it was kind of like, we beat Norway, we're through the knockout for the first time ever. Went to the like quarterfinals where we're going to play Canada. World Cup's in Canada, like all these moments together. Like, I'm finally playing at right back for England. I've been playing left side centre half for the 3 years previous. Just all of that in one was like a really big moment. And I think people always think, oh, like the goal was so good. Like, the goal itself was good and stuff, but it was so much more like background to it.
But you didn't get the tattoo?
I did not. Yeah, I know. Yeah. The thing with Jordan is she's not got a great memory, so she's probably long forgotten about that. And she's scored in the Euros since then, so she would have to get that tattooed as well.
Final question here. What do you think the legacy of the 2023 FIFA Women's World Cup will be? Hosted, of course, by New Zealand and Australia.
I honestly think, like, again, this is so like cliche, but I do think it'll be the best World Cup yet. Obviously, the tournament's been made bigger, which I think is going to be a good thing. I think in the way the game is now, I think we can afford to make it bigger and still have good quality games, which means more games for people to watch.
Yeah.
Again, I'm not just saying this, but like, in two really good countries, like, my first ever World Cup at youth level under 17s was in New Zealand.
Right.
And it was the best experience I've ever had. Still to this day, everybody who went to that World Cup will tell you it was just amazing. So yeah, like, I honestly do think it's just got everything's kind of set up to make it the best World Cup.
Cool. Well, we can't wait. And again, thank you so much for being on the podcast and sharing all your amazing insight and stories with us.
Thanks for having me, though. It's been fun.
That's all for this episode of the FIFPRO podcast, Changing the Game. If you've enjoyed this episode, please do like, subscribe, and review it, or maybe share it with a friend. Thanks for listening, and I'll see you next time.